thoughts have been here, because I have this strange expertise as a former New York State corrections officer, which is I understand how some of their maximum security prisons operate, and of course, the big news this summer was the escape, and how could that possibly happen? And so if you live in New York City and you know something about this, you might get a phone call from CNN or other places asking if you would help talk about it. And they have these eminent sort of law enforcement people who are sort of on call whenever there's a big crime or other event, but they don't, most of them know much about how two convicted killers could escape from one of New York's most secure facilities. How on earth did that happen? And it's been fascinating to actually learn the details of that, but without even knowing the details, I knew a few things. For example, that the officers who get the easiest jobs in a prison, and that the easiest jobs are sometimes the nighttime jobs when the prisoners are locked in their cells, and the jobs overseeing the least troublesome prisoners, such as these two guys were once considered, they live in a special honor block where you only get to live if you haven't caused trouble in recent years. And you can imagine that the night shift is a tempting time to go to sleep yourself if you're a prison officer, especially one who works in a place where there's never any trouble, and especially one, I think, who has 20 or more years on the job in that kind of capacity, used to nothing happening. So it was kind of fun to think about how, as a rookie officer, I might have still, I didn't say this, might have still been following the rules, which is every hour checking to make sure every prisoner is breathing and there in their cell. And still following rules about contraband. As you're aware, I'm sure there were officers who helped their employee, there's an employee who helped bring in tools of escape, but then also officers had a kind of cavalier attitude about contraband, which included for the prisoner named Matt, special paints that he used for his portraiture. And apparently to help him keep control of those special paints, one of the officers gave him access to a catwalk area behind the cells where he could hide them in advance of a cell frisk. Cells are supposed to be, well, where I work, they were frisked every month or so. You would look for, how does contraband get in? I wonder. I'm not sure. Well, I know. Much of it's brought by officers. It includes cell phones, cash, drugs, of course. I was offered a Rolex watch for bringing in drugs by a prisoner on my floor. One of the tests when I was hired was they wanted to know how much credit card debt I had. And you can imagine why, because if you have a lot, you might be tempted. I'd be tempted by the offer of some cash.
So though I didn't know anything about the escape, I did know a few things about what must have gone wrong. And beyond that, it's just kind of an amazing story of ingenuity and, I guess, incremental actions with hand tools and regular forays into the bowels of the building, where they slowly figured out how to get out of there. But it was one of those moments when New York City seemed safer than Northern Vermont. My sympathies were with you in those weeks when they were being searched. I was told that some of the students at the Bread Loaf School of English were worried about the lack of locks on their doors this summer, and I can see why. I can see why. It's kind of scary. So I think I'm best known for my book about prison, but that's the fourth in a series of five in which I've written true stories, all nonfiction, about interesting subjects, not just memoirs, but things I went out to learn about by doing them myself. I believe in the importance of interviews to good journalism and all the other kinds of research you can do, but I think you can augment that substantially by doing something yourself. And the risks of that are that you might claim to know more than you do. So, yes, I rode the rails for several months. Did I become a hobo? I don't say I did, because to be a hobo, to be a tramp, is to understand homelessness in a way that's that I would rather not, actually. It's to know what it's like when nobody will take you in and when you don't mean anything to most of the people in a given place, a given town you're passing through. So I learned a lot more about it than I knew at the beginning, but still, I am me, and I go back to being me afterward. My second book, after Rolling Nowhere, was about a year of travels with Mexican migrants, and no one's going to mistake me for a Mexican migrant, but I spoke Spanish, I still pretty much do, and was able to explain that I thought they had a pretty interesting story to tell with all the travel they do and the risks they take and their lives there and their lives here, and so I was able to find people who would let me just hang out with them, and that's kind of the goal, is to hang out and see what they talk about, how, you know, eat what they eat, sleep where they sleep, and learn about their lives up close. My third book is about Aspen, Colorado. It's a bit of an outlier from the other titles, but it's close to where I grew up in Denver, and I always thought the evolution of a little mountain town was interesting. And I first visited there with my dad, who let me go skiing when he visited clients. He's a lawyer in Denver still. And I'd become aware of Hunter S. Thompson and all the crazy things going on up there in the 60s and 70s, and then the arrival of Donald Trump and big name movie stars in the 80s, late 80s is when I went, and then the gradual sort of transition to just a paradise for very wealthy people above all, really. Aspen's a interesting, beautiful place to live. It's very healthy. I planned to stay there a year. I stayed 2 years. It was very hard to leave paradise, but it had to happen, and I finally moved back down to Denver, where people are less certain of their worth, less good looking somehow. I was struck by that as a single young man. I try to explain it in my book. I also, while there, had re-met the woman who I'm now married to, who lived in New York, and I moved out to New York a couple years later to give that a try. And though I had never aimed to live there, I'm still there. So it's worked out for me pretty well. Tonight, well, I'm not going to explain. I think you'll see exactly what I'm doing here. I'm going to read from two pieces of writing that are related. The first is from Rolling Nowhere, that book about riding freight trains. And the second is from an article called This Is How We Roll, from Outside Magazine just over a year ago. and it will all make sense to you. The reading is 20 minutes long, and then I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have. The boxcar on the freight from McCook, Nebraska, rocked from side to side as the train slowed and crossed a section of bad track on its arrival into Denver. Brakes squealed and doors banged, every sound magnified by the huge echo chamber that is an empty boxcar. My fellow passenger had not spoken during most of the trip, which was okay since I probably couldn't have heard him anyway. But now, as we entered the yards, he started to talk. "Goddamn coal trains," he muttered, surveying the ones we'd have to climb over to make our way out of the yard. I stood in the open doorway of the boxcar, surveying the Denver night. "Hey, get back," he hissed, pointing to the railroad control tower we were about to pass. "They'll put the dicks on us." I retreated to the darkness at the back of the car. "They got a mission here?" I asked him, wondering where I'd spend the night. 23rd and Lawrence," he said with little pleasure, "but it's too late to check in. You missed the sermon. Hell, you missed dinner too, but that's okay. All they serve is some goddamn beans somebody made 50 years ago up in Laramie."
"What I do, I sleep in one of them bad order cars
they got lined up on the UP tracks down there. They don't move them to the shop till morning." I nodded, adding that I was unfamiliar with the routine in Denver. "Oh, it's a good town for eating," he said. "You got the Sally, that's Salvation Army, at 21st and
Larimer at 9 a.m.
Bologna sandwiches at the Holy Ghost Church at 10.
Dinner at the Catholic Worker at 4.
He went on.
"A Denver native, I'd never heard of these places."
The train stopped with a jerk
that nearly knocked us off our feet.
I was cautioned to wait until they broke the air, the signal that the locomotives had disconnected themselves and the train was going no farther.
Finally came the whoosh.
My companion signaled
me to follow, and stealthily
we climbed down from the boxcar and wound our way over the coal trains and out of the yard, entering downtown just north of Union Station. Home looked disturbingly
foreign from this angle.
"My name's Ted," I started. He kept walking. "Well, Ted, one thing you gotta know about Denver, if you got 2 pennies in your pocket, separate them. I'll probably see you tomorrow." And he turned, bedroll over his shoulder, and vanished down Larimer Street. I didn't explain, the book was published in 1984 and researched in 1981 and 82. So some of the language already seems a little
dated. I don't know anyone who says,
who uses the word dicks to describe policemen anymore. Next section is from chapter 10, set in Haver, Montana. "Sonny, open this up for me, would you?" asked the old cowboy, handing me a new jar of instant coffee. "Sure, Pete." I bent forward from my seat on an old couch with a cardboard canopy and met his outstretched hand halfway. It was the right hand, swathed in gauze, now dirty with campfire dust and pus. Pistol Pete settled back onto the long automobile seat suspended between 2 large cans next to the campfire where he'd spent the morning. It sagged, but was still the best seat in the house. The ground wasn't far away, after all.
"Can't
twist with it no more," he said, looking at the swollen hand. It was an explanation, not a complaint. The top came loose for me, and I passed the jar back. "So why don't you get it fixed up?" I asked. "You said the migrant office gave you a check for drugs, right?" "Yes, damn it, and I also said I spent it. Don't you remember that?" asked Pete, annoyed. It was the kind of admission you don't want to make someone repeat. He took a pair of pliers and removed a can black with soot from the fire. He poured some boiling water into a smaller can for coffee. Then he took a dog-eared Louis L'Amour novel from his hip pocket, put on his glasses, squinted shut one eye to compensate for the missing lens, and resumed reading. It was the scene I'd walked in on 2 days before. Pete, evidently absorbed, had started when his partner's dog announced my presence. Then his rumpled cowboy hat tilted back, revealing light blue eyes and several days' growth of white whiskers. His round, wrinkled face might have been cherubic 50 years before. Though it was a warm day, he wore an old down parka dotted with tape where it had ripped. His pants, double-knit slacks instead of the cowboy jeans I would have expected from a ranch hand, were extra long. This, Pete assured me later, was so that he could tie the bottom shut around his boots when driving a tractor to keep out insects. "Hello, Beebe," said Pete. "Hiya, Beebe," I said, raising my eyes to watch the tall tramp, a plastic bag full of crushed aluminum cans over his shoulder, drop down along the path from the road to the jungle. He was dark because of his dirty clothes, old brown jeans, soiled sneakers, and an insulated denim jacket with slits cut in the front for pockets, and dark because of the shade cast over his face by the visor on his cap. But mostly he was dark by virtue of being the dirtiest man I had ever seen. His hands and face and neck, the only exposed skin, were covered with a film of black dirt, heaviest where it had filled the pores. Even his eyes were dark. "Hiya, Pete," said Beebe, who had yet to get in the habit of returning my greetings. Most noticeable about his speech was the backwoods Mississippi accent, and the fact that he formed his words without benefit of teeth, although he looked only about 35. Wiry and lithe, he had the build of someone 10 years younger. Few tramps were both so young and so powerful. It was one reason Beebe had set me on edge. "Much luck?" asked Pete. "Oh, there's probably 11, 12 pound there. What did that be?" Pete figured for a second. "About 250. Enough for a bottle or two.
Or it will be anyway when we cash in that wire, too."
He motioned at the lengths of copper wire coiled near the fire. Some Beebe had found on his canning expedition of the day before, he said, much of it in the form of a transformer coil inside a television set. Since the wire was insulated, Pete had set the thing on fire, melting and burning off the insulation in a cloud of acrid smoke. "Saw them other guys too," added Beebe to Pete.
"What guys? You mean Tiny and that?"
"Yeah, them too. They want to sleep back here tonight, which means they'll want their house back. Which means, son," he said to me, not sounding too sad, "that you're going to have to find yourself somewhere else."
"Huh, where do you think?" I asked, uncertain of just what was being suggested.
"We'll build something later," said Pete. "I'll help you."
"Oh, thanks, Pete."
Beebe dropped the bag of cans noisily and walked over to the tawny mongrel that had announced my arrival. She wagged her tail as he drew near.
"How's Daddy's little girl, Brandy Lee?"
Brandy Lee had been lying on a woolen shirt of Beebe's. He unchained her from his front tent pole, picked up the shirt, and shook it off. Placing it back on the ground, he sat down, tuned a transistor radio at his side to a country music station, and lay back in the dog's place in the shade. Canning was not easy work. Brandy Lee,
meanwhile, set off on a tour of the jungle.
Like most, it had a fireplace in the center. Next to this was a cable spool table topped with food supplies. After lingering near the two, Brandy sniffed out the three wood and cardboard shelters. The one I sat upon, the couch with a roof, was Pete's canopy bed. Another, no more than a crude lean-to, offering shelter to a king-size box spring underneath, was where I'd been sleeping. And the last, a simulated pup tent, made with a plastic rain fly draped over a cord strung between two 2x4s, was Beebe and Brandy Lee's. The dog's next stop was the jungle periphery.
This area, mostly trampled brush, served as a hobo's toilet and garbage dump, and it looked it.
Beyond the polluted zone was lush green shrubbery, which served as a kind of thick fence between jungles on either side, keeping the hobos good neighbors, and just above towered cottonwoods, leaves flickering. Brandy Lee barked in alarm.
"Good girl," said Pistol Pete.
The dog, he'd explained to me earlier, was their doorbell. We turned to watch two figures descend the path from the road.
"Hi-ho!" cried the one in the lead, bearing a bedroll under one arm and a paper bag containing a large bottle.
He wore a dark cowboy hat with a plume in the headband, an old nylon parka, jeans, and glasses. Also young and also wearing glasses was the fellow behind him, but most striking about the second tramp was his size. Well over 6 feet tall, he had a massive, fleshy body encased in a too tight black raincoat. The coat and his whiskers and long hair made him look seedier than his friend.
"Still got this bra, huh?" said the first tramp, reaching over to examine the mammoth-sized bra tied to one of the lean-to poles in the manner of a flag.
"Yeah, we're still
waiting for somebody to fill it," mused Pistol Pete. Say, Tiny, piped up Beebe,
a momentary sparkle in his dark eyes, addressing the fat tramp. You got tits, why don't you try it on? He cracked up. Ha ha, very funny, said Tiny. The first tramp, Roger, came to his partner's rescue. Hey, I saw your girlfriend in town, he said to Beebe. Huh? Who's that? Oh, you know that little girl you hang around with in the hopper at the Safeway. Laughter rippled around the circle, though it was hard to tell if what passed over Beebe's lips was a smile or a sneer. The day before, while rummaging through the big dumpster, Beebe had pushed aside a carton and suddenly came upon an old woman doing the same thing. After the initial fright, they'd apparently had a good conversation. At least he's got girlfriends, said Pete. Tiny, you wouldn't know how to pet a pussy if you had one. Would too, better than you, answered Tiny. How? Hell, I know girlfriends. Yeah, you got girls every night. You take them home and squash them. Oh, here they come, the fat jokes. Who said fat? You did. The jesting continued, helped along by Roger's jug of wine, and so went the days in Haver, filled with talk and drink. Tiny and Roger were waiting for their food stamps to come through so that they could return to Idaho to pick up the ones they just applied for there.
Meanwhile, they were living off
Pistol Pete, Beebe, and me. They promised to pay us back as soon as they could. When the wine ran low, two people, usually Tiny and I, the two youngest, would make a trip into town to change stamps and buy some more. Because certain products, such as alcohol and tobacco, could not be bought legally with food stamps, we'd visit all three of Haver's food stores, buying something small like a candy bar at each, and paying for the purchase with a dollar food stamp. The change was given in cash, and this could be used to buy the next jug. The process was relatively easy, though some checkout clerks would make a scene if they recognized you and it
was your third or fourth candy bar purchase of the day. Late one day, in jest,
Pistol Pete plunked his cowboy hat on my head as I was leaving
to go change more stamps. Now they won't know it's you again, he said.
Everyone laughed but Beebe, and I sensed a sort of sibling envy growing in him. Normally, the difficulty of buying wine kept the supply small, the buzzes moderate, and the conversation civil. But one afternoon, when a concerted effort resulted in more wine to go around, things changed between the tramps. Roger, for one, started prying. You look young, man, he said to me. How old are you? The tramps guessed on my suggestion. 27, 25, 23? 22 was my age, I answered.
Roger persisted, his line of questioning rude for a tramp. What was I doing
on the road? Where was I
going next?
Why didn't I get
a steady job? Suddenly Pete launched into
Roger. Why are you on the road? Because I wanted to
fucking cross the country, said Roger, now very drunk. Because I got
nobody in South Carolina. Well, what do you got here? Asked Pete.
Nothing.
What do you got in the next town you go to? Whatever I find. I'm going to Texas. What are you going to do in Texas?
I'm going to work if I can. Work at
what?
Anything I can to
get a start. Then I'll look for something
better. What I had in mind was a
fucking labor pool. You ain't going to make it. I hope I'm not offending anyone. A fucking thing at a labor pool. Enough for a room, maybe. The future wasn't bright, Roger conceded. He'd been living in South Carolina, his home state, working in a textile mill. After his divorce, he'd moved to Portland to stay with his sister Sue and make a new start. Unable to find work, he'd been supported by her. Finally, as he explained it, he became disgusted. I says, hey, Susie, I need a pack of cigarettes. Like that, man, you know. Well, fuck, I ain't gonna live like that, sponging my own sister for cigarettes. I mean, if you can't even take care of yourself, what's the point of living? So I got me a
effing job
washing effing dishes in an effing restaurant. I met Tiny and got me enough money to buy me a backpack and a sleeping bag, and we took off. Pete seemed
satisfied.
Had Roger been more sober, he might not have missed the chance to ask Pete the same question. Why, you can talk to every tramp you want to. He's got a different story, said Beebe. I didn't have no old lady behind it like you. I couldn't stand my old stepdad, so I run away when I was 14. Went and joined the goddamn army. Couldn't stand it, so I joined the Navy. Couldn't stand that either, so I got out of both of them. When I come out, it was 1966, and I've been on this goddamn rail ever since. Among Beebe's other employers, I'd learned later, were a tugboat operator on the Gulf Coast, the Masonite Corporation, and a carnival. The afternoon drew late and still the wine flowed. On the next bottle of Thunderbird, Roger decided to go dead man. In other words, he threw away the screw on top, which meant the wine would lose its sparkle and get dirty if it weren't finished in one sitting. Tired of the whole scene, I volunteered to make a grocery store run for dinner supplies. As I stood to leave, Roger, barely able to speak, said, "Wait a minute, here, you going to town? Buy me some cigarettes, would you? Marlboros." He reached in his shirt pocket and drew out a $5 bill. "Hey, I thought you said you guys was broke," BB accused Roger. "Well, I just found that," stammered Roger. He was cut off in mid-sentence as BB leaped to his feet, took two big steps, swung his long arm, and landed a fist in Roger's face. Roger, on the car seat, tumbled backwards into the dirt, legs in the air. Kicking furiously, one of his feet caught the pursuing BB in the face. But BB was undaunted and fell on him, punching. The two rolled about the jungle, the blood on their faces forming a dark red mud as it mingled with the fine dirt. With Tiny and Pete on the edge of their chairs, I wondered if the fight would spread. Roger finally eluded BB's grasp for a moment, long enough to get to his feet and sprint out of the jungle, grabbing his blanket along the way. BB, now upright and breathing hard, let him go. He devoted the next half hour to describing Roger in the worst terms he knew. "That two-faced mother," he summed up. "He's only been on the road a couple of months. He don't deserve to call himself a tramp." Then he turned to me. "There's a lesson to be learned here, son," said BB. "On the rails, you don't trust nobody. Ain't that right, fellers?" Pete and Tiny nodded in agreement. Okay, so that was from Outside Magazine, written about 30 years, excuse me, that was from Rolling Nowhere, written about 30 years ago, and the rest is from Outside Magazine from about 15 months ago. My first book grew out of my senior thesis project in college. I wanted to write an ethnography of railroad hobos and to research it by traveling with them. My advisors liked the idea but noted that riding the rails was illegal. I asked, "Well, what if I left college and did it and then came back?" "Might be okay," they answered, and so I did. The book that recounts that experience, Rolling Noah, was published about a year and a half later in 1984. At the time, America had more than a dozen major freight railroads instead of just seven. Reagan was trying to bring down the USSR. Trains still had cabooses, and I was single and didn't have a son and daughter. By 1994, the year my wife Margot gave birth to Asa, all that had changed. And something else happened on that day. I began to worry. Mostly I worried in the way that all parents worry. But in addition, I began to worry in a way that was fairly singular. I worried about whether and when that seed I had planted, the idea of riding freight trains, along with several others, might intersect with the curiosity of a growing boy. Of course, I wanted him to read that first book of mine, as well as the others that followed, about my travels with Mexican migrants, my job as a prison officer, and more. When he was 14 or 15, I gave him copies. But when he didn't immediately pick up Rolling Nowhere, let's just say I was fine with that. Then, early last year, I saw him reading it. "Uh-oh. Great book, Dad," he said as I passed his bedroom. "Yeah, you liked it?" "Yeah, I liked it a lot." About a week later came the moment I'd been fearing. We may have been in the car. "You know your book, Dad?" "Yes." "Well, I wanted to ask, if I ever wanted to go on a trip like that, would you teach me how to do it?" "Teach me what to do? You mean how to ride the rails?" I already knew what he meant. "Yeah." Saying no, we both knew, would be hypocritical. So instead, I offered the compromise that had already been worked out between two sides of myself, the young man adventurer and the father adventurer who's a little more careful now. "Well, I would if we could go together." He didn't hesitate. "Sure." Skip to a section called, or set in Cheyenne, Wyoming. A long walk through town to a catch-out point brought back a memory of a stroll on the same streets with a friend of mine maybe 25 years before. It had been October and cold, and our backpacks attracted the interest of the police, who basically followed us in their cruiser for the better part of the morning and stopped us to check our IDs. Finally, we'd shaken them, but I told Asa about how towns can assume a certain coloration in one's memory after an experience like that, and Cheyenne had for me. My friend, by the way, now 60 and afflicted with cognitive problems, no longer remembers the visit. This time, Asa and I attracted no heat. The UP yard was unfenced, and we sat on an old piece of carpet at its edge, partially shaded by a scrubby tree. A guy in perhaps his 30s, carrying a small pack, walked by and paused. We'd seen a handful of other likely riders in Denver, but this was the first tramp we spoke to. Dressed in clean denim and a work shirt, he was just beginning his trip. He was sick of Cheyenne and going to try his luck in Casper, he said. The BNSF would get him there. Otherwise, fuck it, he'd go to Elko in Nevada on the UP. Just be careful on the BNSF north from Cheyenne, he warned. Trains pass through Warren Air Force Base, and MPs will arrest you if they see you. After he left, I commented to Asa that my goal in college had been precisely to get to know guys like that, no matter how borderline unhinged they might have seemed, and to travel with them if I could. There'd been more tramps back then, I added. By now we would have seen several occupied jungles or hobo camps on edges of freight yards. As it was, we'd seen signs of occupation, such as cardboard that had been slept on and ashes from small cooking fires, but only a handful of travelers. Are you interested in meeting the people around here, I asked. No, Asa replied. He'd met his share of dropouts over years of riding the subway, he said. I'm happy just riding with you. And in watching how I broke the law, he added. Because I know you as a very law-abiding individual. Honestly, when I read your stories, I'm surprised. Really? I asked. I told him I didn't think of myself that way. Frankly, I was more interested in not getting caught than in obeying the law. But on reflection, I could see how I'd given him a different impression. I think it has to do with being a dad, I told him, at the same time wondering whether it had been so necessary to be that kind of dad, the scout leader kind, as opposed to somebody more openly agnostic about rules. Trains started rolling in. There was plenty of traffic, but few places to ride. In the 20 years since my last hop, the rolling stock has changed. Almost all boxcars now have their doors locked, closed and locked. Automobile carriers have doors on the end that prevent one from climbing up and entering the top floor, which the old design allowed. More and more freight trains are intermodal, meaning that their cargo is solely containers, offloaded directly from ships. The big metal boxes sit on special flat cars, most with nowhere to ride. We watched as two westbound intermodal freights and one eastbound stopped in front of us for their crew changes. We the remoras, they the big sharks. Only one of the flat car configurations, the 48-footer, has a safe spot for riding, a recessed compartment or well at one end. The last time I'd been in one in Spokane around 1990, my companion and I had been discovered by a railroad special agent who took down the info on our IDs and said he'd arrest us if he saw us again. I didn't tell Asa that. Out of view of the tower and the engines, we shouldered our packs and climbed between the trains looking for a well. Hoisting oneself up and jumping off a train takes agility, and I have less than I once had. Also, I was nursing a sore knee. Asa, with a heavier pack, had no trouble at all. We walked a long way in the narrow canyons between trains, searching but not finding. We returned to the shade of our tree. There, the wait was short. Around 1 p.m., a mixed freight pulled in. Ten minutes later, we were climbing aboard another grainer. This is a closed grain car. It's like a big cylinder with the ends beveled in and a little metal platform under each bevel so you could sit on that metal part. Within a half hour, we were headed west. The first moments of a freight ride haven't changed for me at all. They're still like the beginning of a romance. Everything new, exciting, energized. A rush of new inputs, sights, sounds, smells. A brand new start. Where will it lead? We tried staying out of sight until we were well out of the yard, out of view of the tower. Then we took some pictures of each other and of ourselves together. And then outside Cheyenne, the train moving at a good clip, we sat back and made ourselves comfortable for a long ride. The next crew change would be in Green River. Driving Interstate 80, which was occasionally in sight, it takes about 4 hours. The train, of course, would take a lot longer. As we passed through the hot afternoon, we watched the grassy plains yield to rolling green hills and then to rockier, red soil hills with craggy pines. All the while, rain clouds gathered dramatically around us. Late in the afternoon, the clouds hung heavy and dark. A few beams of light shot through for brief periods, a fabulous light show. But then the holes closed up and the clouds burst. We stuffed our gear into the opening in the grainer's frame and pressed ourselves in as far as we could go, succeeding in staying mostly dry. "I'm glad we didn't find a flat car to ride on," I said. "We'd be soaked." In late afternoon, the train, which began the trip robustly, made a prolonged stop in Rawlins. To refuel, we were pretty sure, though we couldn't really tell, since our part of the long train was well outside the yard. After a while, Asa asked if he could climb on top of our car, like they do in India. I told him no, the first time on the trip that I'd said a thing like that. For one, he'd be conspicuous to anybody who was looking. For another, stop trains, as I've mentioned, can start with a jolt at any second, and I didn't want my son to topple 25 feet to the ground. The prospect of Asa getting injured had been haunting me the whole trip. And as we moved deeper into the long night, it grew. The view from our perch on the back of the grain car was of the shiny steel wheels of the car right behind us. Our platform had ladders at either corner, a horizontal bar at chest height that spanned its width, and a 4 or 5 inch lip that wrapped around the floor. That was it. Nothing else to stop a fall if the train took a sudden jerk and one of us lost our balance. I didn't know how I'd be able to live with myself if that should happen. It was a bit before midnight when the train stopped again, still not having arrived in Green River. We took the opportunity to finish the cheese, fruit, and crackers, and I told Asa the story of how I'd been in Green River before by mistake. I'd arrived in Salt Lake City on the DNRGW, spent some days with tramps I'd met there, and then decided to continue on my way north or west. I'd hopped on a freight that had rumbled north to Ogden, and then to my surprise and without stopping, turned east. I'd been stuck. Hours and hours it continued in the wrong direction, with me huddled in the rain, beneath the axles of a trailer on a flatbed car in October, until finally the train stopped. Shivering, I'd gathered my things, dropped stiffly off, and learned from a clerk at an all-night convenience store that I was in Green River, which I caught the next westbound freight out of. Asa said he remembered some of that from the book. Our train jerked forward, then back. Asa neatly grabbed a bar to steady himself, and I looked away. My anxiety over the possibility of him tumbling into the space between our car and the one behind had grown and grown despite my efforts to tamp it down with reason. Finally, I told him, "It may not be logical, Ace, but I'm totally frightened that you're going to fall off the train." "Why? You think I'm being careless?" "No, not at all. In fact, I'm impressed by how quickly you've picked everything up. You've paid attention to everything I've said, and you get how a train works. You're brave, but you're not reckless." This was pretty much my highest compliment. His mother had tried preparing him for this concern of mine on the night before we began our journey. "He's probably going to be really nervous," she said of me to Asa. "He was with me, I know that." Another story. Now I explained how 99% of my previous riding had been by myself or with tramps and brought with it scant need to watch out for others. So this is a new role for me, because during our lives together, one of my main responsibilities has always been to keep you safe. And this is somewhat dangerous. So it's hard to shift gears. I'm having kind of a hard time with it. Seldom had I spoken so directly to my son about my own difficulties. After a minute, he placed his head on my upper arm as if resting. Then he put his arm around my shoulder. I put my arm around him, looked straight at the back of the grainer rumbling in front of us in the dark, tried hard not to cry, wished the moment would last and last. That's it. Thank you. So you reach a certain age as a writer and you look back at things you wrote before and you realize a different person wrote that. And it's kind of interesting to wonder if anything's been lost, to think about what's been gained, to compare yourselves. And I was thinking about this reading about a month ago, and I thought, I'll put those together, and then maybe the listeners will see a difference. Anyway, I'd be happy to try to answer any questions about those experiences or any of the others, any questions about writing, publishing, prison break, whatever might be of interest. Yes, sir?
You lose much weight in your overall experience, and heavily to help with your...
Yeah, I did lose weight. I caught one cold, I got head lice, and I was smoking about a pack a day when I got home. But fortunately, I was able to stop smoking, and the other problems weren't too hard to fix. So a little bit because I was bored, but more because I really wanted people, I wanted to meet people, and I didn't know how. And I knew if I had cigarettes, people would want to meet me. And once I also did the same thing with wine. I thought, I'm going to buy some wine. And then, so I hadn't talked to anybody new in 3 days. But after that, I never did that again. Because you just don't know how somebody's going to get when they've had too much, right? Some people are quite pleasant. This isn't just tramps. I don't need to explain to anybody that. Some people, you're just sad. You help them get drunk. Yes?
Do you think you want to have memories to remember the dialogue and the experiences and write notes right after it?
Yeah, that's a good question. Whenever possible, I wrote notes right after. I don't have a notebook with me right now. I wasn't going to take notes about you guys. But I usually have one in this pocket or in this pocket. And one thing I would do when I went on those runs to the grocery store is write down all the interesting stuff I remembered from the last 2 hours. And I'd write it down just briefly so that I'd be able to reconstitute it later when I had more time by myself. I have a pretty good memory, an ear for dialogue, but it's not verbatim, it's reconstructed. And what I do try hard to do is if I hear a phrase that is unusual. I still remember Roger saying hi-ho when he came into the camp. I thought, that's weird. And that's kind of interesting, and I'll keep it. And there's another scene here where he's telling Tiny, you see Roger, you tell him not to come back or I'm going to give him a stain that blood and water won't wash out. Like, whoa. Who has phrases like that at the tip of their tongue, you know? And it turned out, as I discovered in North Dakota, sometime later with them, we were reading the Sunday paper and it had Parade magazine with a feature story on the nation's toughest penitentiary. Marion, is it Illinois? I think it's Illinois. And we're looking at it and BB recognized prisoners in that article and I thought, oh, I'm out of my depth. That's really when I got scared. And he didn't like me, because Pete did like me. That's all it was. Yes?
How did you present yourself to these people?
Yeah. I was on leave from Amherst College, and I said, I'm a college student. I'm researching a project. I wanted to do it firsthand, and you know, appreciate you helping me out. And the second tramp I met heard me say that. I'd traveled with this guy actually several times over the course of my whole experience, but we'd spent a couple days together. He heard me say that, and he said, "You gotta stop saying that." I said, "Why?" He said, "Don't tell anybody you don't know what you're doing. That's like the dumbest thing I ever heard. Why would you ever tell somebody you don't know what you're doing?" And I was like, "Oh, okay." He said, "You wanna meet people, carry more stuff than they have so they don't think you're gonna steal theirs. So carry, I don't know, an extra, whatever." He said, "Just don't look desperate, don't be interested in their things." And yeah, cigarettes wouldn't hurt. But he told me to stop telling the truth about myself. And so basically, I did. But I didn't have to make up another story, because it is rude to demand to know why somebody's there. And you get over certain, I hope this doesn't mess up the camera, you get over certain mannerisms of polite society where you meet somebody and you hold out your hand, right? It's almost a reflex. Yeah, see? See? But you do that with a tramp around a fire, and he's going to look at your hand like, what are you trying to pull on me, right? Some false bonhomie, right? Like, let's be pals, and then I'll steal your stuff. So they're really suspicious, and in a way, once I got that, I didn't have to work so hard. I could just be there, listen to them, and I found that by listening to people, like, a lot of people don't get listened to a lot. And if you're a good listener and you're really paying attention, many people really like to talk, and many tramps were like that. So that
So did they know you were writing?
No. No, they didn't. They didn't. Though the guy I dedicated the book to, that first man I was telling you about, he knew. I don't think he believed me. I know. I told two guys in Seattle I was actually writing a book, and they told me they were brain surgeons and a professor of philosophy from Harvard. And so I think they thought I was bragging when I said I was a college student.
So you didn't go into this from a creative writing
book. No.
What was your writing background, or how did you, obviously you're a good writer, did it just come natural from the journal?
I'd always been pretty good at writing, and I'd worked for my school newspapers and then for a college magazine, and I'd spent a summer actually as an intern at U.S. News and World Report. But as my agent said, when I finally got an agent and had written him a letter describing this book I planned to write, he said, "Well, I can see you're okay with the short sentences." And that's the challenge if you have a journalism background, is how to be more of a storyteller and more expansive and talk about yourself, which especially back then journalists never did. Yeah, so
I have a question about the book Newjack, which I read most of, but it was so depressing I had to stop.
Oh no.
Because of the, I actually have a horror of prisons and the whole idea of prison. But the Dannemora prison where these two people escape, I heard recently that after that escape, they were the cellmates or the people on the cell block or whatever were interrogated and basically beaten up and threatened and just horrible things happened to them.
Yeah.
Has that been, you know, have you followed that? Has that been verified? Did they really do that kind of stuff? I mean, I think I read that they were threatened with waterboarding because the investigators or whoever was doing this was trying to get information about where are these two prisoners? Where do they go?
Right.
How do they get out of here? Does that kind of stuff really happen, or is this just allegations?
We have to assume it's an allegation. I mean, it's an allegation. There's no, I don't have a way to know if it really happened, but I must say it doesn't sound unlikely. Because by escaping from that prison, those two guys humiliated a whole town.
They humiliated years of protecting, I mean, years of protecting the public. Bang. Not only did these two escape, they were gone for hours before anybody knew. Hours. Like, this is a high security prison. They committed murder. One of them dismembered his former employer. Like, so, and then, and this is like Attica, when officers lost control of the prison during the Attica riots, the state police were brought in to restore control, and that's a humiliation. And who shot the first guy, Matt? It's a federal officer, right? It wasn't the state corrections. They were further humiliated by not being the ones who solved the problem. And the second prisoner was caught by somebody else who wasn't in corrections. So it's been one thing after another, and as is, I'm afraid, sometimes a tendency in corrections, a bad thing is can be followed by another bad thing. Like, it's quite, seems conceivable to me that those officers that,
in the New York Times is what I read, that said the officers,
in groups of three, had gone around to other prisoners in that housing block and tried to intimidate them into telling more about how it happened. And I think the impulse is not completely, I mean, it's completely wrong and horrible on every level, but it's not completely irrational, because you imagine that if you lived in a metal building and your neighbors had been sawing your common back wall with a file for 4 months or however long it took them to cut those perfect squares, and then to walk behind the thing and use other tools. I mean, many people must have known that was happening. Even Governor Cuomo asked the guy in the next cell, "You didn't hear anything?" "No, Governor, no, Governor." He was only the first public official to say, "Really? Nothing? How funny." And so it was just, they did it in the dumb way that they knew how, or thought they should try, and they thought they'd be protected by prisoners' lack of access to the media. And as I understand it, prisoners complained to prisoner legal services, and the Times pieced together several reports and compared the details, and the details were similar. I don't know if it's true, but it certainly sounds possible. And I'm afraid, too, there's a sort of culture of impunity at some of these, especially, I think, remote prisons, where the whole community depends on the prison, right? And is proud of it, and it feeds everybody. So no one's going to be, you know, there's going to be a pretty good wall of silence around that place. And it's a shame. I think prisons would be better if they were more transparent. And I think the public would admire prison officers more if they felt they were not just waiting to beat somebody up. And I also think most officers are not like that. But a situation like this can bring out the worst in people. The people I worked with were good people, but the system does encourage you to act in certain bad ways. Even as there's plenty of rules that say you shouldn't do that, there's a culture can grow up that is bad. I don't know if you saw the past commissioner of the State Department of Corrections, after these Attica officers were convicted of brutalizing a prisoner, first time ever a corrections officer had been convicted in an outside court of hurting a prisoner, the corrections officer said that prison should be closed. And it's because of the culture. And to save themselves, these prisons have to be better. They can't let bad stuff happen. They have to, officers need to direct energies towards stopping the bad apples and making the place something you can be proud of. Yes? I'm sorry, you weren't raising your hand. Yes?
Yeah,
couldn't believe that you wanted to be able to try your hand at being a Hobo profile, but getting a job as a corrections officer, how did you do that? I mean, did you do it in good faith, or did you have a project in mind before you started? Or?
I totally had a project in mind. I would never have done that for fun.
It's more scary than me going Hobo.
That's an interesting question. They're scary in different ways. So the Hobo life is scary because of randomness. You don't know when kids will throw rocks at the train or when some crazy person will find you when you're asleep. That's scary. And all the alcohol is scary. And moving trains are scary. And they're dangerous. But in prison, it's more a question of daily stress. Especially if you're new, you're not this tough guard you see on TV, right? You over there. It's not like that. I go, you over there, and he goes, fuck you, honky. I mean, it's just like, and especially if you're not big, and I'm not big, and that means I have to talk to people, and I have to negotiate. And
you don't have what?
Well, I have a baton,
right.
which could as easily be used against me as by me. And, that said, officers do look out for each other. And one day a prisoner who was running, which they're not allowed to do, came around the corner really fast and ran right into me, knocked me down, I'm on the floor, an officer coming up from the other direction heard the noise, ran around the corner, and he said, what happened? And I looked at the prisoner. I said, what happened? He said, I'm so sorry, CEO. I'm so sorry. I shouldn't have been running. Oh, I feel so bad. My fellow officer was ready to punch him, was ready to inflict damage on my behalf. And I felt this love for him, which I was totally unexpected, right? He's not a lovable looking guy, but he's ready to put his neck on the line for me. And so this solidarity develops. That's a powerful thing, and that does make you think you might be safe, as long as you've also got a pin on your radio that lets you call for help. One day, this is very embarrassing, I was reaching for my keys and I pulled out the pin. And I was scared to death when about 30 seconds later, this team of linebackers comes running around the corner looking for the trouble to come to my aid. So it is scary, and one-on-one, you know, people will try to intimidate you. They'll walk right up to you. And on my first day, a guy tapped me on the shoulder. I turned around, and he pretended he's going to punch me and stopped right there. And my heart practically stopped. And he laughed and walked away. And I said to the training officer, that's 102.7 threats to an officer. And he said, what, you're going to write him up for that? And I said, yeah. And he said, not around here, man. They'll laugh you out of the disciplinary committee. The lieutenant will say, so tell me what happened, Conover. Inmates scared you. Is that what happened? Inmates scared you. And inmate has to hurt you. And then you have a complaint. Yes?
Yeah, I'm wondering how much preparation you did for Rolling Nowhere. Did you read, were there ethnographies, or had any, you know, Hobo's written books about the experience, or did you just go in cold? I think that's the idea we have, the journalists who immerse themselves sometimes, just kind of, you know, one day they're at their desk and the next day they're driving the rail. But did you look at maps? Did you map out your route and all that?
I prepared as much as I could. Like today with the internet, I'd be able to prepare a lot better. Mm-hmm. But then I only was aware of a couple of magazine articles, several books of history about riding the rails, you know, some stories by Jack London that described different trains altogether. with blinds and rods underneath and stuff that didn't exist anymore. And I knew a handful of people who'd done it. And all, so I wanted to minimize the risk to me, and so I talked to as many of those people as I could. I don't know if all journalists would do that, but I really am not interested in getting hurt, believe it or not. And I'll prepare as much as I can, if it might help. Did that answer your question? Yes.
Yeah. Can you talk a little bit more about the book, the migrant worker experience, a book about that?
Sure. So that was actually my most enjoyable project. While riding rails, I met a lot of Mexicans who were using the trains to get where they needed to go, because there's mostly private police patrolling railroads, not local cops, and certainly no immigration officers except along the border area. And I'd realized that with my public high school Spanish, I could have a conversation with them. And they were curious that I spoke some Spanish, and found me kind of amusing or whatever. And I had the feeling this would be a great subject, you know? Because back then especially, mostly we knew about illegal aliens from like those news shots of the trunk of the car being opened in California somewhere and all these people blinking in the light. I thought this could add a good dimension to the whole debate and answer some questions, and so I, I got started by working, by teaching English classes at night for a farm workers group outside Phoenix, and met a lot of migrants, basically young men my age, who, when they left, said I could come with them. And what was so nice after riding the rails was these guys looked out for each other, and they weren't damaged. They were ambitious, and they wanted to have fun. And if they messed up, they'd go home. Like, you know, that, they didn't think of themselves as invaders. They were just on an adventure. And so, not every part of it was enjoyable. But the only physical harm I suffer in Coyotes is when I fly with a group of guys on a cheap Southwest Airlines flight to LA after their car broke down. And in an all-night coffee shop, I'm thinking, I'm gonna be the only white guy. Like, that's what the trouble's gonna be. Well, who comes into the coffee shop but a drunken sort of punk white guy saw me talking with Mexicans and punched me. Which the Mexican guy who picked us all up thought was hilarious. So I'm like holding my eye, he goes, "So why did the cuate hit you?" And I said, "It wasn't a cuate, it was an American." And he goes, "What?" I said, "Yeah." He thought that was so funny. It was not funny. Yeah.
If your book on riding the rails had not been picked up, do you think that you would have had an entirely different life?
That's a really good question. I probably would have had a very different life, because whoever thinks they can write a book, I certainly wasn't brought up to think that, and I'm not sure I would have devoted years to trying, given that I needed to make a living somehow. And I like to think I would have stuck with it, but I don't know. I don't know. You had a question.
To change the subject.
Sure.
What happened to A-70 and how long have you been on the trip?
So after 5 days, he told me he'd had enough. Because we'd ridden several freight trains and had boarded two of them while they were moving, which he didn't tell me at the beginning, but that was his real goal. Was to board moving trains like they do in the movies. And I get it. And it's uncomfortable. You get hungry, and you get hot, and then you're cold, and you wait hours. So I understood. And I was prepared for a month-long adventure, but it wasn't for me, right? He'd had enough. I didn't want to prolong it. Yeah. I am. I have a long piece about a large animal veterinarian in Iowa coming out in Harper's Magazine. It's in the October issue. It comes out in September. I got interested in veterinarians because I didn't mention this. I became a USDA meat inspector a couple of years ago. I thought that could be interesting. And got hired at a Cargill plant in Nebraska. And it turns out my supervisors there were veterinarians, and because they're experts in animal disease. And so even though they went to vet school to take care of animals, the job market has changed. And it is a hard job, especially as you age. Like, big animals can cause damages, some of you probably know. And all of a sudden, the Food Safety Inspection Service, part of the USDA, is the country's largest employer of veterinarians. And I thought, that's so interesting. And it seems kind of wrong. I mean, I want the food to be safe, but they're supervising slaughter, like 3,300 cows a day in this plant where I worked, which is a lot. And there's a total of like six veterinarians who work there. And I proposed the subject, the story to Harper's, which had assigned me to go out and be an inspector. And the problem was, after they read my inspector story, most veterinarians were very suspicious of me because they're part of that economy of, you know, beef and helping farmers. And the magazine used the word undercover in the title, which I guess makes sense, but it wasn't exactly how I went in. I kind of went in to see what it was like. And anyway, after about 6 months, I finally found a vet who would hear me out. And I told him I was not there to get the goods on him. And if I saw something that made me wonder, why are you doing that, that I would tell him. There wouldn't be any secrets. He wouldn't be surprised by the article. If I said, why don't you use anesthesia when you castrate, we would have discussed it. And in fact, we had that discussion, and that's in the article. There's some old-fashioned things vets do that I think they'll start doing differently as the world changes. But mostly I admire the guy. He's trying to do an old-fashioned job in a good way. And, so that's my next piece of writing. Yes?
A question associated with that. How does one get to become a USDA inspector?
Are you interested?
What about, yeah, there could be an in-between job. Yes, something like this could happen.
Yeah.
How much training? What is it? You get these jobs, you must train them.
A little, well, it varies. I did, for corrections, that was like 7 weeks of training. To become a red meat inspector, you qualify either through experience, and most of the other inspectors had experience in a slaughterhouse because they're from small towns. And or you can have meat preparation experience, like in a butcher or a grocery store. I think if you'd work the meat counter and cut meat, that counted as experience. Or you could qualify through sufficient math and science credits in your undergraduate degree. And I thought I had enough when I applied, and it took like 9 months for them to tell me I did not. So I took a distance learning course, pre-calculus. I was never very good at math. And took a pre-calculus course online and made the credits. And then I was offered a job as a temporary inspector. So it's like an adjunct professor or something. Your future is not guaranteed, but there's always a shortage somewhere. And I said I'd take the first job that came. And I didn't tell any lies when I applied for either the prison job or this. That's the one thing you just can't do, because then you've committed fraud. And when I applied for a prison job and they, you know, who's your employer? It's myself. What are some of your previous jobs? And it was all true. I managed an apartment building. I tutored kids in Spanish. I taught Stanley Kaplan SAT preparation, you know. Anyway, when I applied to be a meat inspector, I was a professor at NYU, and I thought, oh man, this is a problem. But you can work around these things with some creative thinking. So I put NYU as the employer, and it said, describe your duties. And I wrote, I work in the building. I still work in the building. That said, before I make myself out sound too clever, 2 months into the job, I got a letter saying we were now going to complete our in-depth background investigation. And for that, I would have to supply the names of my immediate past supervisor, my next-door neighbor, my best friend, and a relative. And they would ask all of them about me. And in fact, I got 2 more weeks out of the job while those people waited to get the letters, and then I quit. Because I didn't want them lying on my behalf. And also because my arms were they're almost better now, were hurt by the repetitive nature of the work. You cut into big pieces of beef and use a hook and a knife to look for signs of disease and abscesses and liver flukes and all this other stuff that you find in meat. So I was happy to quit, even though I didn't. Then I thought, there's probably not a book here, but it's not as interesting in a slaughterhouse as in a prison. It's a factory. Every day is a lot the same. Yeah.
First question is, do you still eat meat? And then I actually wanted to ask you, as a writer and a teacher of nonfiction, I'm wondering about your thoughts on recent revelations about the great New Yorker journalist Joseph Mitchell and the biography that sort of pokes holes in a lot of
sure.
What he did, and curious if you teach his work, and if you do, I guess even if you don't, how you would teach it differently now, knowing what you do.
Mm. So until that question, I'd wondered if you were a corrections worker. I don't think so. I did, my last night, I'd stopped eating meat except for some chicken and tacos by the time I left Nebraska, but my best friend inspector invited me to his favorite steakhouse the night before I left, and I was totally frightened because I thought I might just not be able to swallow, and instead it tasted really good, and that's how my article ends. But in the year and a half, almost 2 years since the article, I've tapered off. I don't eat. Almost don't eat any ground beef, and I've only had maybe a couple of pieces of steak. Don't eat much pork, though I can't give up bacon yet. I'm working at it. I eat less, a lot less. As for Joseph Mitchell, if you didn't read the review or read that biography of him, it tells a lot about how much of his supposed factual writing was, a composite in the best case, and part to some large extent invented in the worst, right? This is a continuing conversation in nonfiction writing, really since its efflorescence, its blooming in the 60s and 70s with Hunter Thompson and Joan Didion and Tom Wolfe and great writers who took journalism and nonfiction writing and made it and showed what else you could do with it. And Mitchell was a pioneer in the attention he gave ordinary people and the way he valued them as a subject. He was not subjected to scrutiny in the way anyone would be now. Fact-checking for my veterinarian piece at Harper's took about 5 full days of work for me to supply their fact checker with all the sourcing. Mitchell never had to supply any sourcing, it appears, and I don't teach him. I don't find my students relate to his writing very well. I admire it and I judge it by the standards of his time. I don't say because he was loose with facts, he's not worthy. That's what it was then. But it's different now. Anybody can fact check a story by Googling in 15 seconds, and they do. They do all the time. And the blurry area now, it seems to me, is in memoir, which is the main thing I'm teaching up at Bread Loaf, because in a lot of memoir, you simply have people writing a version of their life as they remember it. And in most cases, that doesn't directly contradict another account, right? Maybe you had a mean old mom, but unless your piece is published and she's still alive, you're not going to be held to account for that description of her. And there are cases where memoir writers do identify real people in their lives and portray them in an unflattering light, and then you get into disputes about factuality. But there's lots of cases. Yeah, what's the guy's name? Running with Scissors. You guys know that memoir. If I remember the author's name.
Burroughs?
Yeah. Something like that. He was sued by a family who had taken him in as a foster kid, who he portrayed as heartless and abusive in ways which they claimed in their lawsuit they were not. And he had to agree to changes in the way he described a book. Like the words "true story" were removed from the cover, and some other accommodations were made. But writers have a lot of protections in the United States to pretty much say what they want, as long as it's not recklessly defaming somebody. If you say it in good faith and you have evidence for that, you might get sued, but you probably won't lose. And anyway, the memoir is where you find most embellishment and stretching the truth, but I think it's harder and harder for journalists to get things wrong, or other nonfiction writers. Just
that change in the craft.
Definitely, there's you can't play loose with facts. And look at Brian Williams, right? I guess did he post on Facebook about the plane he was in, and then the pilots of the actual plane said, no, that's not how it happened. And his a Facebook post and his career is turned completely upside down. And that it wasn't even news, right? I mean, it was his account of his own reporting experience. So there's just lessons like that around young writers everywhere. And I think most of them are paying attention. Anything else? Thanks for coming, everybody.
Thank you. Yeah.